You with me? Okay. Now, something else happened here. Along the way, in playing with these three models, turn the hopper and pull out skills and drills. Let's balance these 10 general physical skills so that you're well, you have balanced in breadth and depth and capacity, cardiorespiratory endurance, stamina, strength, all that model, and the balance of the molecular approach here. We had observed along the way something that was kind of a curiosity at first, and in the original What is CrossFit, What is Fitness document that has been a kind of a capstone CrossFit document and brought a lot of people that brought you into this movement, brought them in, we had observed as kind of a curiosity that there was a continuum, it's called, between sickness, metrics, measures of sickness, wellness, and fitness. That is, we had observed that if I could quantify any measure, if it was truly a measure that I could put numbers to, of it was be of something that would be of interest to, say, a physician or an exercise physiologist, potentially, whether they're interested or not, I guess it's true, what we'd find is we'd sit well ordered on in this pattern. Let me give you examples. Let's look at body fat, okay? You understand that if you're 40% body fat, that's considered pathological. You've got a problem. You're morbidly obese. There's some numbers floating around, I don't know what they are, 15%, make it up, every community seems to have a different one. That's well or normal. 5% is more consistent with what you'd see in an elite athlete. Bone density, same thing. There's a level of bone density that is pathological. It's osteoporosis or osteopenia in the early stages. There is a value that is normal. They say, yes, you have normal bone density. We find gymnasts with 3 to 5 times normal bone density. I can do this with resting heart rate, with flexibility, with all of the 10 general physical skills. Even some subjective things where we can put numbers to it through analytical methods like mood state. There's a sense of well-being that's normal. The athletes are a different breed altogether. They kind of hang out with Superman complex. And then there's the depressed. I do not know of a measure, even something loosely obtained through like subjective kind of analytical psychological methods, I do not know of a metric that runs counter to this. This led us to believe that fitness and health were varying different measures of the same reality. Suggested that rather strongly. And so we were on the road lecturing, and we're dealing with these three operational models and this fourth curiosity. Weren't sure what this fourth piece, what its significance quite was or not. But we did understand this, that if there's anything in your lifestyle, in your training regimen, in your recreational pursuits, take that broadly, if there's anything in your life that has one of these metrics moving in the wrong direction, I want you to seriously entertain the possibility you're doing something profoundly wrong. Because what we find when you do CrossFit, when you're doing constantly varied high-intensity functional movements and eating meat and vegetables, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, no sugar, and getting to plenty of sleep every night, that we don't have this specter of what we would call side effect. I don't have, wow, everything's getting great, but this one value is just going the wrong direction and quickly. And that is not the exception, but is the rule is to be expected with medical intervention. So your physician might have a plan for you for body fat, but it might reduce your bone density or your muscle mass. And it may be that your doc has a solution to your cholesterol problem, but the drug gives you a stroke. That happens, has happened, still is happening. And we didn't see that phenomenon. We didn't see like, wow, everything's been great, except this one thing went to shit since we've been working with you. Never saw that. And so we knew there was something significant here. We knew that this could be kind of another test in assessing what you were doing. And I was watching Pat Sherwood struggle with the presentation of this in Brooklyn back in November. And he was doing a brilliant job, but then I was like, as it was coming, I go, man, this is the fucking part I hate, is trying to explain how these three models interface with this bit. And this was important enough to us, again, because it showed that fitness and health seemed to be varying degrees of the same reality. You know, not different facets, but just different measures. lousy value, good value, and excellent one. And we didn't want to get rid of it, but we needed it in there. And where it logically tied in, like we weren't quite seeing, and we were going on with this, and I'm watching them hit this thing, and all of a sudden it just came to me in a flash, and it looks like this. And if I apologize for anything technical, it might be here. But the problem is lies with me, not you. I'm going to try and draw here. So we got this fitness. Remember, we got power on this axis. And I've got duration of effort here. And we made the claim that that curve here would represent your fitness. You with me? Well, check this out. If I add a third dimension here, and the real measure of this is, do you see 3D? You get the corner of the room there? You got that? We're looking into a corner. And what I'm gonna do is, forget this line. You don't see it. It's just gonna help me to do something kind of real. Look what I'm gonna do here. Can you see that? Can you see that I've produced a solid coming down and forward out of the corner? Good, because that's not a beautiful graph. It ain't bad either, but it's entirely determined on those of you who go, I see 3D, then fuck, it's a good one, okay? Here we are. Look, this is fitness. I'm just going to work back into that. I don't want to hang out into the third dimension too long, make anyone dizzy. I come back here to two space. This is fitness. Let's look at some of the things that the exercise science community, let me tell you a problem with exercise science. It is very, very rarely scientific that would meet the rigors of anyone who's actually studied science, real science, chemistry, physics, engineering. And it is almost never about exercise. Isn't that interesting? So exercise science is neither science nor about exercise. And we look at the things that crowd looks at, and one of them is VO2 max. I'm going to tell you right now, you hear anyone talks too much about VO2 max, I'm going to tell you they're very likely not doing science and do not understand exercise. That's just a fact. It's a dead-end bullshit thing. VO2 max, let's take lactate threshold. Let's even look at something like this isn't bullshit, strength. Here's what I'm going to tell you. These things are correlates, maybe components, but absolutely, positively subordinate to what happens here. To wit, who would take an increase in VO2 max for a decrease in work capacity across broad time and modal domains? Let me tell you what that translates to. When we hook you up to the tube and pinch off your nose and run you on a treadmill, man, you're using more air than you ever have before, but you're going to lose the race. Lactate threshold. I'm going to improve your lactate threshold, but you're going to get choked out in your fight because of a lack of work capacity. Is that a good deal? Okay. If you're winning, if your performance is there, if you can demonstrate high levels of fitness, I don't really care about these things. That being said, let me tell you what we've been doing at CrossFit. By using constantly varied high-intensity functional movements, designed to elicit a broad, general, inclusive fitness, a fitness that would protect you from the unknown and the unknowable. By looking at a curve like this, what we found is that we have made very significant improvements in these things in almost every athletic community without ever looking at them. And I'm going to tell you, and I can make a list of hundreds of these things, and no one has ever produced a great athlete by taking those things one at a time and building back up to something that looks like an athlete. Doesn't happen, doesn't work that way. The place that works is hanging out in university, avoiding athletes and coaches with a tremendous effort, getting a bunch of silly little bullshit degrees, your name, generally non-science degrees, and feeding off the public, eating out of the government trough. It'll work there, but not in the real world, sir.
So those can all be components of...
They are correlates, that is, just somehow connected by mechanisms not understood, or they are components, essential, but the bottom line is they are subordinate, that I'm not going to develop fitness by advancing them. I'll let those nuts measure them and go, oh, geez, how are you doing that? You know, they tell me they're important. I say they're not. Then they find out that I can move them better than they can. I can move them best by working constantly varied high-intensity functional movements, doing things that look like Fran, Diane, Helen, turning fitness into sport. By working with fixed workloads and trying to minimize the time by making every workout a competitive effort amongst a cohort. And when I do that, what we find is that these metrics do spectacular things, but fuck them, I don't care. What happens is I'm maximizing the area under the curve. Now let's go back to 3D. Here's the shocker. This piece here is fitness. This here, this is now, I hope you see, is a three-dimensional solid. That's health. It's health. And I have the same relationship to things that seemingly matter. HDLs, the good cholesterol. Ejection fraction, how much blood the heart can empty in each pump. I can play this game all day long. Just about anything that the doctor will tell you is important to your health, what we find is that we can get, the hypothesis here is that we can maximize this volume by maintaining our work capacity across broad time and modal domains through the ages as you get older and older and older. And I can play this same game. I can ask, are these things just correlates? Are they components? And are they indeed just entirely subordinate to? Well, there's a compelling body of evidence. It is my belief, my thought, I think where we're headed. And look, right or wrong, this still needs to be measured. I want you to understand that. It still needs to be measured. But I'm of the opinion that health, that this volume will be maximally held by maximize your area under the curve and then hold that work capacity as long as you can. In other words, eat meat and vegetables, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, no sugar, learn and play new sports that will CrossFit in 100 words or less, do the constantly varied high-intensity exercise throughout your life on a good diet. And that will buy you more health than will trying to, I'm going to fix my cholesterol, I'm going to improve my bone density, you know, and likely the medical approach here would be pharmaceutical intervention. So I'm going to take a drug for my cholesterol, I'm going to take a drug for my bone density, I'm going to take a drug for not sleeping well, and I am of the opinion that it's a failed approach, much as this is a failed approach. And it makes sense to me that if I'm really interested in maximizing the solid, I would take the two-space model and hold it as high and as for as long as I can. But let me ask you this. Suppose you think good cholesterol is really important, HDLs, and I want my HDLs up, and I'm going to really focus on an HDL guy, okay? Suppose I had a guy who at 90 years old has 65% of the work capacity he had when he's 25, which was also in about the top 5 percentile of all people your age. And now at 90, there's not one in 1,000 your age. In other words, here you are 90 years old, you're running up and down steps, you're successfully engaging the ladies, and if someone tries to take your wallet from you at the ATM, you're going to fuck them up, all right? And you're 90. You picture the guy? Okay. Suppose I tell you, yeah, but he's not in good health because his HDLs are high. Would you right then and there go, hey, I tell you what, man, you can have my wallet and my dick won't work when I meet the ladies and I need help getting up and down the steps, but my cholesterol is fucking beautiful. Do you want that deal? Of course you don't. Of course you don't. Of course you don't. I can look at even longevity, even the single axis here. Is the goal to live forever? Or is the goal to maintain as much functional capacity for as long as humanly possible? Theodore Dalrymple is an editor for the Wall Street Journal and a physician that's a pseudonym for who knows what his real name is, doesn't matter. He's famous as Theodore Dalrymple. But he says that the overwhelming majority of the increases in longevity that occurred over the past, you know, in the modern era over the past few hundred years, that medical science can take almost no claim for it. That it can almost be attributed all of it to hygiene, sanitation. He also says that the way forward, the big gap, the big improvements are not going to come through a pharmaceutical intervention, not through surgery. The MDs aren't going to provide. He says it's going to come through fitness. That's what's going to do it. He's looking at exactly what we're looking at from a very different perspective, from the perspective of a physician who's in a great position to understand what I see is deficient in trying to take chemopharmaceutical intervention to fix these components or correlates, these subordinate measures, and think you're going to build back up to a good life. If I look at longevity alone, you know, there's an instant problem here. Can you imagine if this curve, if this blanket, as it will, that's coming out of the corner, if it goes way low, so you never have any work capacity, but it stretches out to 200. Is that a life that any of you want? You know, I'm not here to say yes or no. I'm not here to say that. What I am saying, you know, I'll tell you, my personal view is a resounding fuck no. But you know, that's for everyone to determine. That's a normative kind of thing. We're not talking science when we're talking about that. But let me tell you this: it is imperative, it is essential for doing science, for making meaningful assertions, that it be measured this way. The metric is important, not what outcome you'd like to see. I have this fear that someday medical science is going to get average life expectancy to 150. And yet it's still at 75, you go into the nursing home and they're wiping your fucking ass and feeding you with a spoon and you're watching Oprah all goddamn day long, you know, for 75 years. That to me was like dying at 75 and going to hell. And you know, if someone wants that, I mean, there'll probably be a time and place where that can be arranged, but it's not what I'm looking for. And it's really not what CrossFit's about. This is about vitality. It's about capacity. What can I do? Getting things done. And what would that be? Stop someone from taking my wallet at the ATM, successful engagement of the ladies, right? And to be ambulatory. I want to go up and down the steps, man, without help. What we have here is a unification of fitness and health. It was hinted at by this continuum. Remember the values, everything sat well ordered, where the normal or well values sat between the pathological and the fit. That, by the way, that continuum also tells me something else. If you are fit, you have a whole bunch of qualities: blood pressure, cholesterol levels, bone density, resting heart rate, body fat, that before you can become pathological, you'll have to be well. It tells me that fitness is a hedge against sickness, with wellness as an intermediate value. That's how profound it is. Questions? The exercise science community, that people neither doing science nor exercise, they're of the view that these are entirely different worlds, cannot be bridged, cannot be unified. Look, whether there's fruit to it or not, I'm going to tell you right now, here's a metric that proves otherwise. What significance comes will remain to be seen. But if we are going to develop a science of exercise, and CrossFit is leading the world in that, if we are going to, we've got more scientists, PhDs, MDs, trainers, coaches, athletes, and more money and greater reach than any organization in the world today studying fitness, doing fitness. Questions? Stunning, huh? Nothing. How about lunch? Is that next? Am I blowing? Okay, all right. Thanks for your time, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.